Hello, and welcome to this preview for the IMF Summer School's online course, Public Sector Debt Statistics, or PSDSx. Public sector debt statistics are considered one of the most important fiscal indicators for the fiscal health of a country, and are much watched, politically sensitive, and consequential statistics. Whether public sector debt is increasing or decreasing can result in important changes in public tax and spending policies, can move financial markets, can support or undermine the wider economy as businesses and households anticipate how government policy will change, and can ultimately help governments get re-elected or removed from office. That's why the quality and accuracy of public sector debt statistics and their international comparability are vitally important. The full course covers the wide range of issues involved in compiling public sector debt statistics. It sets these statistics in the wider context of fiscal data and government finance statistics, or GFS. It explains the GFS framework and the statistical concepts of balance sheets and debt. The course provides a framework for thinking about which entities should be included in government or public sector debt statistics. It introduces you to the different types of debt instrument. We explain how debt should be valued, how and when debt should be recorded, and how it should be compiled and disseminated. Finally, it provides guidance on how to make debt data analytically useful. The course also covers some more difficult areas that relate to debt, and that's what this IMF Summer School video focuses on. As well as incurring debt by issuing bonds or taking loans to fund government spending or deal with revenue shortfalls, governments can take on debt through less common routes, by making debt payments on behalf of others, or by assuming debts from other companies, or getting involved in financial bailouts. Governments can also take on debt and disperse the funds raised to another entity. For example, the central government may borrow funds from a creditor and then create an on-lending arrangement with one of its state-owned enterprises or a lower level of government. In the examples you are about to see, we explain how these operations should be recorded and how they should be recorded in public sector debt statistics. The PSDSx course is based on the recommendations and best practices detailed in the Public Sector Debt Statistics Guide for compilers and users. If you're a PSDS compiler or a data user, there's a lot for you in this course. Register for the full PSDSx course for free at imf.org/learning. I hope you decide to join us.
Let's say a state-owned enterprise borrowed 100 from a local bank.
This loan is guaranteed by the central government. The local bank is the creditor and has a financial claim on the state-owned enterprise. The state-owned enterprise is the original debtor and has a debt liability to the local bank. As guarantor, the central government does not incur a liability of $100 on its balance sheet. But by issuing the guarantee, it does create a potential fiscal risk for itself.
A year later, the state-owned enterprise is in financial distress and cannot service its debt of $100.
The local bank calls the guarantee, and the central government, as guarantor, becomes the new debtor. The debtor-creditor relationship between the state-owned enterprise and the local bank is now terminated, and there is a debtor-creditor relationship between the central government and the local bank. So, after the debt assumption, the central government owes $100 to the local bank, and the state-owned enterprise owes nothing to the local bank. What happens after the debt assumption between the original debtor and the guarantor depends on several factors.
Is there an effective financial claim or agreement established between the guarantor and the original debtor? Is the original debtor still a going concern? In other words, is it an entity that is still in business, or one that will be operating for the foreseeable future? Is the original debtor a public corporation? Let's say a state-owned enterprise borrowed 100 from a local bank.
This loan is guaranteed by the central government. At some point later, the state-owned enterprise is unable to repay an installment of this debt because it has a temporary cash flow problem. Under the terms of the guarantee, the central government then pays this one installment on behalf of the state-owned enterprise. In this case, the financial relationship between the state-owned enterprise and the local bank remains the same.
What happens between the state-owned enterprise and the central government depends on whether the government has an effective financial claim in the form of either a debt instrument, such as a loan, or a non-debt instrument, such as equity, on the state-owned enterprise.
If the answer is yes, then the central government records an increase in its financial assets, such as loans. The counterpart entry is a decrease in its financial assets in the form of currency and deposits. The state-owned enterprise records a decrease in its original debt liability to the local bank and an increase in another liability to the central government.
This new liability could be in the form of a debt or a non-debt instrument.
If the answer is no, then it records an expense in the form of a capital transfer, which we classify according to the nature of the debtor.
The counterpart entry is a decrease in financial assets in the form of currency and deposits. At the same time, the state-owned enterprise records a revenue in the form of a capital transfer and a decrease in its original debt liability to the local bank. Let's say a publicly controlled bank is in financial distress.
The central government intervenes by providing financial assistance, also called a financial bailout, to the bank. In macroeconomic statistics, we refer to such financial assistance as a capital injection. Depending on the circumstances, this capital injection is recorded as a loan, a capital transfer, an acquisition of equity, or a combination of these.
The government may also have intervened indirectly by extending the range of guarantees it is prepared to offer to the financially distressed corporation.
Broadly, three main issues arise with bailout operations that may or may not affect GFS and or PSDS. The first issue is the sectorization of the entity or unit created to finance or manage the sales of assets and or liabilities of the distressed corporation. This is normally called the restructuring agency. In particular, the sectorization is important for determining whether the agency's transactions, other economic flows, and stock positions of debt liabilities, as well as other assets and liabilities, are within the general government sector or the public corporation sector. The second issue is the appropriate statistical treatment of the capital injection. In other words, as a loan, a capital transfer, an equity injection, or a combination of these. If a loan is involved, government and, more broadly, public sector debt would be affected. If an equity injection is involved, government and public sector debt would not be affected because equity is a non-debt instrument. The third issue is how government has financed the financial bailout. In other words, did government borrow to provide the bailout funds to the distressed corporation, or did it dispose of some of its financial assets to do so?
If the financing of the financial bailout involves debt instruments, then such financing would affect government and, more broadly, public sector debt. Let's say a state-owned enterprise wants to borrow $100 to finance some of its investment activities.
External borrowing would have been much cheaper for the state-owned enterprise, but it's not allowed to borrow abroad. So, instead, government borrows $100 on behalf of the state-owned enterprise from a bank abroad. And then government on-lends these proceeds to the state-owned enterprise.
So here we have two separate financial claims.
First, the foreign bank has an external financial claim in the form of a loan on the government. Government has an external debt liability in the form of a loan to the foreign bank. Of course, it is also possible that this debt liability is in the form of debt securities or another debt instrument. Second, because of the on-lending, the government has a domestic financial claim, typically in the form of a loan, on the state-owned enterprise. The state-owned enterprise has a domestic debt liability in the form of a loan to the government. Because the government and the state-owned enterprise are both public sector units, these stock positions will be eliminated in consolidation when statistics for these two units are combined. Typically, the unit to which government on-lends is a resident, inside or outside the public sector. But it could be a non-resident too. In that case, an external debt liability and external financial claim are involved.
The servicing of these two separate debt liabilities should also be handled with caution. The repayment of each of the two debt liabilities is recorded in the books of the unit in whose balance sheet each debt liability appears.
Thus, government has a debt liability to the foreign bank. The repayment of this external debt liability is recorded in the books of the government, even if the borrowed funds were on-lent to the state-owned enterprise, and if the state-owned enterprise is, in practice, repaying the foreign bank directly. Similarly, the repayment of the state-owned enterprise's domestic debt liability to the government is recorded in the books of the state-owned enterprise, regardless of what happened in practice.
As you can see, we record these economic events separately and do not offset them against each other.